Howdy folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas about to bring you into a red rock wonderland. On this episode, we're going to be exploring a section of Route 89 at the base of the Vermilion Cliffs of Arizona, one of my favorite landscapes. Although we are technically not pointed towards the cliffs just yet, they're off to my left. Very shortly, we're going to change our route and head in a westerly direction. So a lot of this we're going to see from the car. We are going to get out on foot, hike a little bit. I even hear a rumor about an old uranium mine out there somewhere in the wilderness. So we're going to seek it all out.
Well, good morning, my Vermilion Cliffs explorers. I got up really early this morning, like at 4:30. It's about 6 a.m., not quite yet. And the sun is rising off to the east that way. And now I'm hoping that we're gonna get some really nice color to come out of these cliffs as the sun comes up. So my plan is I'm gonna actually drive back the way I came, since it's not far down that way. And then hopefully by the time I turn around and come back this way, the cliffs will put on a little bit of a show for us. So it's a theory anyway, we'll see. But before we head on the road, let's check out this Cliff Dweller's Lodge, where I actually spent two nights. So here are my accommodations at the base of these beautiful cliffs here. And this is not a historic building. This one was built in the 1990s, I believe. And the rooms were, they're clean, I'll put it that way, but don't expect anything fancy here. But then again, if you come out here, you're not looking for fancy. And these are the, I think these are carport style. You don't really use them as carports anymore, but I think at one point, would they not park their car in there? In the front, they had a couple like that, that you still could park in. So, very small, but I like. I just wanted to come this way just to test my theory out. A little first rays of the sun are kissing the top of that cliff over there, and it is glowing kind of reddish purple, I would say. Turn around and look. I mean, the sun is going to be up any second now, so I should probably really hustle to make the best use of this.
A thought that I'm pondering right now is, would I do something like this if I wasn't doing this YouTube channel? And I don't know if I would or not. Probably would be sleeping in. But that's why this YouTube channel is so healthy for me. It actually makes me want to get out and capture phenomenon like this. Sunrise on the Vermilion Cliffs. Drinking a Coke. It gets me all crazy, that sugar and caffeine. I think right now is some prime viewing on these cliffs, so I was gonna drive back down 89A towards Phoenix, for those that you know, after I cross Navajo Bridge to come up on these, but I don't wanna squander this opportunity. So I might turn around here shortly, or at least pull over where the Vermilion Cliff sign is that we saw sunset.
You see, your buddy Glenn sometimes gets it right. Think I got it right anyway. Much better than late afternoon, so let that be a lesson to you. But boy, there almost ain't nothing finer than a Vermilion Cliffs sunrise.
Alrighty, we're now truly gonna head back west, and we're gonna part this region and head towards Kanab. But we still have plenty to see on this episode, so don't go anywhere yet. We're not done. All right, we're gonna drive straight at the cliffs now, the Vermilion Cliffs at sunrise. Cue the music. Wow, this landscape is now fully lit up. The sun officially has risen from behind the mountain behind me. Hopefully it doesn't interfere with this camera now, but absolutely stunning here. I had to pull over very quickly here to plot a course to this uranium mine. It's known as the Sun Valley Mine.
Continue on US 89A north for 8 miles.
There you go, 8 miles, she said. So I'm not sure, once we get past the Cliff Dweller's Lodge where I stayed, we're heading back that way, how things are going to look cliff-wise, but once we get on foot to the uranium mine, it should be pretty sweet. my hopes with the mine, as always, are that we can see the mine, and I think I've seen, if I was looking at the right pictures or videos, I think there is a shaft or two that go really far down. And I want to try a new experiment. I'm going to bring a headlamp and a flashlight and just see how much further we can penetrate the darkness with that as I throw a rock deep into the mine. So I'm going to be really disappointed if I don't get to do that. I'm pretty sure I will. I downloaded an All Trails GPS for it, but I reckon it's going to be a short one. I don't think it's going to be that long of a hike if we're going this direction towards the cliffs. If we're going out that way somewhere, it couldn't be long either because there's deep canyons all over the place. This is what we did this for. There you go. You got more cliff that we're driving straight towards here. Down very lightly traveled roads. I'm telling you, this is nice. No semi-trucks to contend with so far. I'm loving it. Alrighty, this is the trailhead for the Sunset Valley Uranium Mine. I was kind of questioning it at first, but it's here. All right, so the Sunset Valley Uranium Mine trail. All Trail says it's 2.4 miles round trip, so out and back. So about 1.2 miles or so. That way, straight back. I see the trail. I assume we're gonna kind of get up against the cliffs really close and maybe even start to ascend a little bit. Not sure yet. So let's go see what this is all about. And yes. So mine features. Hazards may exist. So those are my footprints right there. I walked and set up a shot, but I don't see anybody else's, and this dirt really gives way, so I think it's been a while since anybody's hiked back here, maybe. You know, I can already tell this was the perfect call, just if we wanted to experience the Vermilion Cliffs, uranium mine or not. Like, we're walking straight into it, so it's right in our face. With each passing step, the cliffs just get taller and taller and taller. I love this. So a quick note about the mining operations here. I read that I think they started in the 1940s and into the 50s. And there's lots of uranium mining in the Vermilion Cliffs area. This is not the only one. It's certainly not in operation now and hasn't been for a long time. That breeze feels good. But you can really get a nice view of the country around here. The road is down on that plain. We've come up a little ways here in a short amount of time, and you could see all those washes and canyons, and the Colorado is way out there. I think I could see the gorge that it carved out from here, but it's hard to tell with the sun. And it looks like we're only gonna go up from here. Woohoo! That's why we do this, folks. I actually see the car way down there where we started. Man, yeah, you climb. You climb good. Woo. That's worth it though, look at that. So this is a great place to get an overview of the situation here. I'm looking approximately south, so you're looking towards Flagstaff and Phoenix, and you see that wall of mountains over there, those cliffs. Pretty much you're coming from the south, driving parallel to those. And eventually you hit the Navajo Bridge, somewhere out there near the Vermilion Cliffs in Lee's Ferry. 89A goes this a ways, and if you see out on the horizon, the faint hazy cliffs out there, we're gonna be climbing that elevation. It's gonna turn into pine forest, I think, at some point as we head over towards Kanab, Utah. But an interesting note, an interesting fact, is somewhere out there is the north rim of the Grand Canyon, and there is a lookout point, actually, where you can look back this way. I think it was called Point Imperial, and we filmed it, and you could see the Vermilion Cliffs and look back in this direction. So right now, there's probably somebody aiming their camera in this general direction as I aim it right back at them. Cool, I actually see some old machinery actually. Our first clue that there was a mine out here. We always need to return though to our focus, the Vermilion Cliffs. And now you're getting a really close up look at them. So neat. All right, so here's that stuff. To me, this looks like maybe the remnants of an old truck, maybe some kind of an old trailer. This is maybe a bed. It's kind of small though, isn't it? But there would be your grill and headlights. So that is so freaking cool. So yeah, I'm guessing this is all part of the same machine. I can't really make out what was written on that gate here. It doesn't budge, but made with wood. So that's a sign of an old vehicle. I was not expecting that. This is really cool. And I'm not sure if that's like a, you know, part of the engine maybe, like the wheels. You got springs and all sorts of cool stuff. This is a cool find, actually. Not that I found it, but I mean, I found it for myself and didn't know about it. That counts. Whoa, look at the contrast in color here. This is an amazing photo op. And actually we're going down too for the first time since we've started heading up. Wowzers. Holy moly, look at that. That would be cool to explore. I bet you could access it if you just follow the wash up here. I'm not sure if this is a box canyon. Assume it ends at some point in dead ends, but how cool is that? This hike has got so many interesting things. Rain is rare out here, but when it rains, oh boy, does it. And we had a couple humdingers in Phoenix this year that Amy could tell you about. Not gonna get into those details, but it can get pretty violent. What we really came here for though is the Vermilion Cliffs. And this hike delivers big on that. It's right there for you to see for yourself. And I couldn't be more pleased with how this ended up turning out. This exceeds all of my expectations. You can see the mine over there. We're gonna head that way. One thing I can tell is if you follow that canyon that we saw, this is where it ends up, really. This is the start of where it starts to dig down and get in there. And it really originates from over this way. There's a closer look at what I assume were rails leading to the mine shaft over that way. I've seen a couple barrels too along the way rusted out. Some more old wood, remnants of buildings and other things they built. And this barrel has seen better days. Very rusted out. I don't know what was in there. Looks like there was something in there. At one point, probably just dirt and rock. They filled it up and it fell over. Maybe it's uranium. Yeah, that probably to me, these look like the remnants, I'm gonna guess, of a headframe. That looks like a pulley. And this is probably the frame, just completely busted up and fallen. Makes sense being right next to this shaft. Pretty small shafts actually. But typically what they would do back then is lower people down via cages to work the mines. I don't know how many tunnels are down there. And to lift up material that they're mining out. And you see other things strewn about here. Old wood, basically, and metal. And what I'm assuming, once again, is an old headframe. Wooden headframe with mine shafts. How would you like to come to work here every day? You'd have the greatest views for a while. Until you descended into the depths. Even though, you know, they got the safety thing there, I mean, it's kind of sketchy and freaky and dark, but we are going to illuminate that in a second. This is a cool shaft. I love the wood shafts like this. Very neat. Rock throw, take one.
heard it hit maybe the wall or something, and then silence. So was that thud the bottom? I don't know. Let's try another one.
This time I'm gonna try to throw one more central down the shaft. I feel like the Hulk just grabbing rocks. Not really. Mine rock toss take two. Shall we? We shall. Ugh, I hate doing this though. Gives me the heebies and the jeebies. Ready, set. Let me get this straightened out here, I think. Film.
I'd say as far as old mine shafts go, this one gets an A. I love the wood going down, and only disappointment is it didn't look as deep as I would have imagined when I zoomed in and we saw the rock fall, but that's okay. So you did, when you heard the thuds, that's when it hit bottom, but it looked like a bottomless pit. And trust me, it's deep, so don't worry about that. And then the ladder and that other entryway. I wonder if they had them separated where they were pulling stuff up out of one side and then the men would climb down ladders to get down there. If they took ladders, it seems conceivable, but once you get down there, I don't know what's going on. There are probably tunnels and other shafts. All right, so we're at a point now, we get to turn down, and it's all downhill from here and then flat, so that's nice. But we gotta get back to the car because we're not done touring the Vermilion Cliffs yet. There's still a couple more things we wanna seek out, but this here was amazing. This has got it all. The scenery, the history, mine shafts. I love it. I absolutely love this.
All right, Sun Valley Mine, you were awesome. That was amazing. I loved that one. But we gotta get back on paved road. Oh my God. Just not being on loose dirt or driving on rough road and just chilling here like this. It's the way it's supposed to be. I'm also assuming off to the right, those are also part of the Vermilion Cliffs. That would only make sense. So it's kind of weird how these cliffs wrap around, actually. And I think what we're going to be stopping to do is, you could see we're climbing elevation already, but there should be some viewpoints, I think, scenic viewpoints where we could pull over and get some nice video and pictures. So, and the cliffs look absolutely beautiful over here. You could barely see them, I know, but the roads are also endless, and I just love the sage. I assume that's some kind of sage or some kind of grass and maybe sage bushes mixed in. If they've gotten as much rain as we've gotten in Phoenix, you know, the desert might be more vibrant now than usual. It's very green. And then when you have the red cliffs next to them, it's just such a fantastic sight. So there's a historical marker. I'm curious, and I want to get pictures of this area anyway, as it's so beautiful. So we're just going to pull off here and see what this is all about. We're on, still in the thing, I think. This is the, oh yeah, I've heard about this. The Dominguez-Escalante Historic Trail. This is pretty elaborate, actually, for like your average roadside historical marker. They really did this one up. So you tell me, was it worth stopping for this? To take a moment. And bring it all in. Breathe it in.
So Amy, I feel horrible because she's at home and she opted to do some yard work and trim trees and stuff, which normally I would help with that, and she took care of it, sent me pictures. She's texting me right now, I think. So this is what I'm doing, Amy, while you're doing yard work. That doesn't seem right to me. See, that's why you need to come on these trips.
So I wanna see what this monument is about, because this seems to be a crossroads of some sort. Very strange and elaborate.
I'm so glad I stopped here at this stop. I actually took the time and read all of the signs, every word of it, because it really caught my interest, because some of it ties into some of the history that I'm researching right now for other videos I'm making, a lot of Mormon history, frontier history, stuff like that. So what this is all about is Dominguez and Escalante were two fathers, and they were trying to establish an overland route from Santa Fe, New Mexico to California, and they didn't actually ever make it. This was in the 1700s, but they did camp in the vicinity here that we're currently standing in. So that's really what this monument is about, is a tribute to those fathers, and they came out here to spread their religion and stuff with the natives, and you know the story, but that's really what this is. So somewhere these guys camped.
The thing is, their work was not for vain, because the route they did establish, and as far as they got, let others build off of it in the future. And that's exactly what happened. When you got into the 1800s, the Mormons that lived in this area actually created an overland route between places like here and St. George, Utah.
So an interesting thing is, on this old trail, this old road that went through here, it was nicknamed the Honeymoon Trail, because the Mormons that lived here in this part of Arizona would travel to St. George, Utah to go to the temple to get married. So really interesting history there.
Imagine, yeah, just, you know, instead of driving by gasoline-powered cars, we were in horse-drawn carts and wagons still. And how slow going that would be compared to today. I think with oxen and stuff, they wouldn't try to push them more than, I think, 16 to 18 miles a day without, you know, risking injury to the animals. So, you know, compare that with how far I drive and how far I go today. 75 miles an hour, usually on the average, through places like this. I also should probably take a moment to explain the plan, what we're doing. So 89A is right out there. Don't see any cars driving yet, so it'd be easier to see that if there were. But you see that big rise on the horizon. I don't know what it's called as a geological feature, but like if you're going to the north rim of the Grand Canyon, you would drive the way we're going. And I think we're just gonna straight up go up on that plateau up there. And then at some point, we'd be able to stop and see the cliffs from up high. That's the plan. It's kind of loose, and I didn't look at maps, but I did look at a couple maps, but I didn't really burn them into my memory, so cross your fingers. All right, 89A, here we are again, and all the history now. I had no idea until I started my recent studies. I've been reading up just on a lot of Mormon history around one particular historical thing, doing videos on it. So I've been learning about this. Some names that were on the sign were familiar. There are towns named after one of the guys, Hamblin, that are now ghost towns in Utah, but really cool to draw the lines and understand and piece together those puzzles. So see the last little bit of the Vermilion Cliffs on the right on your screen over here. Very soon, we will have to be looking back to see them. It's almost hard to believe, and you can see the road faintly out there. It's hazy, but we drove around like those cliffs and were on the other side like that way and drove all across this valley following a historic trail starting to get paved in the 1700s by Dominguez and Escalante and finished by the Mormons, with a lot of help with the native folks, I am sure, throughout the centuries leading up to that. Amazing.
So the thing that just occurred to me is, when you think of manifest destiny, when we all learned about that in high school and people coming in wagon trains and traversing prairies with prairie grass and sagebrush or red cliffs, it actually happened here. And this is that iconic scene that we all have burned into our mind. The Vermilion Cliffs. I hope I did this justice on this episode and made you want to come out here and visit and explore. And I just scratched the surface, but I gave you a taste of what's possible. See you next time.